Mit navn er Markus Vester, ja, og jeg er arkitekt, og så sidder jeg i Københavns Borgermission for Socialdemokratiet, hvor at jeg også sidder i vores teknik- og miljøudvalg, og jeg er også teknik- og miljøoverfører. Fremtidens by for mig, det er en grønnere by, hvor der er mere plads til mennesker, og alt det, som vi gerne vil have meget mere af, det er cykler, det er grønne områder, og det er plads til udfoldelser. Noget af den plads, det betyder, at vi for at få mere af den plads, så skal vi også tage noget plads for noget andet, og det vil i fremtiden især være biler. Vi skal gentænke vores by, så der er færre biler, og der er mere grønt, og mere plads til menneskelig udfoldelse. Så det tror jeg er fremtidens by, og det vil også være en by, der er sundere og bedre for os, der bor her, og det vil også være en måde at imødekomme de udfordringer, vi står overfor med både miljø og med klima.
Can you just give us a short introduction and idea when and why Copenhagen decided to become a front runner in terms of carbon neutrality and resilience?
Originally, we adapted a version in a climate plan from 2009, and that's also what we have used for the COP leading up to the COP 15 in Copenhagen the same year. And what we then modified was that old plan from 2009 into the new 2025 plan, which were adopted in 2012. Following also some of the cloudburst, actually a big cloudburst, so some parts of new development in Copenhagen leading up to we as a city saying we need some higher ambitions, we need some goals even further out in the future, trying to deal with some of the issues we are facing.
Copenhagen managed to reduce its energy consumption. How does this actually go together?
Well, we have try to work with different stuff in that way that we are trying to make more energy saving issue is trying to energy saving actually a lot. Also, of course, as a result of national legislation saying that we needed to do something more as a way of actually reducing the energy consumption while we are sitting growing. So that's how we're trying to do it. With retrofitting and upgrading our yeah the different infrastructure leading to having a issue.
What other sectors does Copenhagen focus on?
We are trying to increase the quality of life here in Copenhagen. We have been mentioned as the number one livable city in the world multiple times. Trying to make less local pollution, more green, and of course very much focusing on quality, high quality biking infrastructure as a way of getting you around the city, as well as looking at affordable housing. We are thinking that we can create more green growth with investments while we are transitioning the city and creating jobs and exporting, of course, also green solutions to the rest of the world. So we've been reducing our emissions across different sectors. With working with energy consumption, energy production, mobility, and so on. Of course, also waste disposal. You have seen the Copenhagen Hill, with where we're actually having a waste disposal system underneath a skiing hill, even though we haven't got any mountains here.
What is important concerning democratic and social participation? So, how do you make the city's plan also the Copenhageners' plan?
Course, we have tried to engage the citizens in this transforming the city. And as I mentioned before, biking is a very big part of Copenhagen. It's in that sense a very flat city. We haven't got that much many hills, and this of course makes it easy for you to get around. And biking infrastructure is one of the key issues for us in the city as we're promoting a green mode of transportation. While at the same time, we're also looking at how can we reduce like private car ownership, even though I have to say it's gone in the wrong direction, but nevertheless, we have seen a high increase in bikers in Copenhagen, and of course, also the use of public transportation as well. The coronavirus has put some limits to this, but otherwise, we're trying to do this as a way of actually getting the citizens as a part of it.
What do you think? How can local municipalities and cities boost their resilience or foster their resilience ability? What would you recommend? Can you somehow give us policy incentives?
Well, of course, we have tried different approaches. Where we have the power to do so, we are actually trying to make the changes there. As a supplier as well, with the district heating, water, city gas, and public transportations, and also through partnerships with campaigns, networks, facilitation, and sharing information. That's one of the issues.
Copenhagen is one of the cities that is long time governed by the Social Democrats. Can you give us a hint what the secret is behind this political success, and in what way does an ambitious climate plan heading towards sustainability and carbon neutrality goes hand in hand with a social democratic policies?
As a social democrat, we try to balance it, be pragmatic in a way that sometimes you will see other parties on the left and third out on the left, they will probably propose make some proposals that would actually, I would say, push people away from the big issue, of course, transforming our city into something better. So we are trying to balance it with the right wing at the same time. And I think as a social democrat, you are placed somewhere in between, of course, on the left side of the center point. But in the same, while we're doing this, I think we are making the balance that you need to do. And a better future has always been a key point, of course, for social democrats. And then when we're talking about climate and the way we have to transform our city, this is, of course, a part of the future. And if we don't act, then we'll see a future that's not better, but worse. So we have to do this as social democrats. And I think the way that we're doing it, trying to mingle people from the different parties and making them find a balance as well. I think that we that's one of the reasons that we've been leading here in Copenhagen for so many years.
So actually the social democratic idea would be about balancing on the one hand, and on the other hand, having the vision of a better future, of improving people's life.
I would say you will see different parties, they are saying that we should get totally rid of cars right away. And we want to have less cars here in Copenhagen. But I think if you are going to going out and waging a war on car owners, I think that we will actually see a counterproductive reaction from those car owners. And that would probably lead to that we are not making the right actions in this regarding this issue. So if we don't find this balance, then people would probably vote for other parties not going in the right directions. That's what you can also see in national politics. So I think that's one of the ways that we've been doing it. And of course, we need to do something, and that's also what we're doing, but we need to do it in the right pace.
What do you think is the next really big challenge concerning green mobility?
We need to reduce the number of cars in Copenhagen. We need to reduce the car ownership. We need to increase the number of bikers. We need to increase the number of citizens using public transportation. We need to make better public transportation. We are, of course, trying a lot to make more increasing and expanding our metro system. And then we also need to have this discussion, I would say, on how to, as you said, how to use the space that we've got. Because right now, cars, they take up a lot of the public space. We could use this for something better. We could use it for more bike lanes. We could use it for broader sidewalks. We could also use it to make some more green areas in the city. And in a city, that would be a game changer, I would say, because it would also make less pollution. It would give a higher livability, and an incident of Copenhagen livability is very much a key issue. And it will also be a way of combating heat island effects. And even though Copenhagen has been a leading city for many years, I would say we also need to take inspiration from elsewhere. I'm very much inspired by Anne Hidalgo and the Paris new, the quarter city. And I think that as in here in Copenhagen, we also need to look what they are doing, because I think that's very ambitious, and I think they are trying to take the lead in a different way than we've been doing. So I'm very inspired what they are doing, changing the city completely. And I think that the city that they are proposing in Paris, I think that could be, or I think that is the future for Copenhagen as well, and probably the rest of the big cities in the world.